हेलो एवरीबॉडी, गुड इवनिंग. आई एम रिचा अग्रवाल फ्रॉम इमामी आर्ट एंड कोलकाता सेंटर फॉर क्रिएटिविटी. आई एड लाइक टू एक्सटेंड अ वेरी वेरी वार्म वेलकम टू नवजोत जी एंड थैंक यू सो मच फॉर बीइंग अ पार्ट ऑफ द इमामी आर्ट टॉक्स. दिस इज द इमामी आर्ट टॉक्स सेशन 2.0. उष्मिता एंड मी हैव बीन टॉकिंग अबाउट दिस फॉर अ लॉन्ग टाइम एंड When the COVID started, we realized that we wanted to do something which spread more positivity and more energy. So this is something we started with. I'm not going to take any time today. I'm going to hand over to Ushmita to take the evening forward for us. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Richa. Thank you, Navjot ji. Welcome to our Imami Arts Talks Conversation Series 1.2. We are really honored to have you with us. And I'll read out your bio and then we'll delve right into the program. Navjot Altaf's practice involves painting, sculptures, installations, video and site-specific works that negotiate various disciplinary boundaries. Her methodology ascertains the interactive aspects of collaboration, and the work emerges out of an extended dialogical interaction combined with deeply engaged readings of historical and contemporary art, film, and cultural theory. She has been engaged with indigenous artists and the communities in Chhattisgarh since 1997 and is interested in understanding the significance of transdisciplinary work, whose nature is not merely to cross disciplinary boundaries. Navjot has been participating in national and international seminars, including Anthropocene curriculum at the House of World Culture Berlin, 2014 and 2016, and Goethe Institute Mumbai, 2018. She's one of the founder members of a center, Dialogue Interactive Artists Association, Kondagaon, Chhattisgarh, has organized seminars, discussions, Samvad 1, 2007, Samvad 2, 2011, Samvad 3, 2015, and Samvad 4, 2019 at Dialogue. Her numerous solo exhibitions in and outside India and her participations include, and I include a very few, she has participated in amazing and widespread exhibitions across the world. Samkalik Earth, Democracy and Women Liberation, PAV Parco Arte, Vivente Tour in Italy 2019, KB19 Flight Interrupted EcoLeaks from the Invasion Desk, Karachi 2019, Open Borders, Curitiba Biennale Brazil 2019, second edition of Chennai Photo Biennale India 2019, The Earth's Heart Torn Out, Navjot Altaf, A Life in Art, A Retrospective, NGMA Mumbai 2018 and 19, Starting from Desert, Ecologies on the Edge, Yunchuan Biennale, China 2018. Navjot lives and works in Mumbai and Bastar, India. Today's session, as per Navjot's preference, will take the form of a presentation followed by question answers. Please do not forget to write in your questions in the chat icon at the bottom of your Zoom screens. For our Facebook Live viewers, please do write in your questions and we will try and accommodate as many as time permits. Navjot ji, I hand over the evening to you. Welcome.
So Ushmita and Richa, thank you very much for inviting me for this session and the entire team behind the conversational series. So before showing and discussing my works, I would like to briefly speak about what I have been interested in, what matters and moves me intensely in life, and how do I reflect and conceptualize my perceptions of the world I live and move in, and how do I position my articulation through a language I like to continue to develop. I agree with the idea that one doesn't know the world through the application of independent rationality alone, as we are constantly jolted into thought by an encounter with the world, its times, its matters, and its capacity of effect on us. And how, and now more so because of the huge impact of digitalization of communication and information systems transforming all the time. Artists as intellectuals have been universalizing the crisis to give a greater human scope and to associate their experience with events in other parts of the world. Yet the context in which artist works, researches, and experiences situations need to be understood deeply by the artist and those who engage with the artist's practice, because each place has its peculiar or unique set of conditions. From the early years of my practice, I have been exploring and re-exploring how man-made asymmetries were introduced and have continued to persist in human relations and in human societies, in which for some of the people, others are seen as depersonalized objects to be used as a means to an end without any regard to their existence or personality. And such alienation effects have been familiar and visible in the history of, human relations. For example, in class, caste, minorities, and gender struggles, etc., etc. In the context of ecology as well, systems of relationships have been disrupted through the authoritarian human interventions at almost every level, which opens up a question concerning what and who are we really caring for. And in the context of recent crisis, if we look at the socioeconomic and political systems we have allowed ourselves to be in, the vulnerable state of the economically disprivileged, like the migrant workers, including those who had to walk on foot for miles and miles to reach their homes, severely impacted by poorly planned and callously imposed nationwide lockdown, lacking in any primary concern for this section of the population, unrecognized, but in reality, the backbone of the urban economy that we all can see if we want to, is not different from the alienation effects I mentioned above. And these socio-political and economic impacts on human and non-humans alike have made me more and more interested in the exploration of a method of inquiry that, as Edgar Morin, a French philosopher and a social scientist, whose approach is called complex thought, points out, is multifaceted enough not to reduce reality, but rather honor and engage its complexity. Unlike complications, disarms the explanation based on single and linear logics. It requires multiple logics that are neither separated from each other into neat boxes, nor integrating neatly with each other, but enter into ambivalent relations and tensions in the universe, in nature, and in our reality. Most of my work since the 90s have evolved from my interaction and the process of working with people from different fields and areas, which helps me reflect on different perspectives and interventions apart from my own. What position do I take as an artist during the process of engaging myself with the people and during the process of research, my struggles, which many a time leads to uncertainties, unanticipated or peculiar situations. But I think the political choices and decisions made by the artists, actually I'm referring to myself, made by the artists, help them analyze their own sensibility in depth, which defines their aesthetic and political and politics both. My concern at this stage of my life and the way the world is moving is to create spaces which could embrace the struggle for emancipatory knowledge, its transformative and effective potential to ask deeper questions and to secure cultural spaces that allow for critical reflection and to apply critical thinking. So our center at Kondagam, Diya, is built with these concerns and values in mind. So now we can see the works and I can talk a little about
Yeah, sure. I'll start the screen share.
Yes.
Can you see this?
Yes, I can.
Yeah.
So, okay. So, this work, Journeys of Transgression, are two works, two last works in the series of works that I had done called Images of Women in the 90s. And both these paintings look at the gender by both male and female artists in Surrealist movement. And because I feel that in Surrealist movement, even though women played a very significant role, somehow its gender issues remain questionable. And so because the movement was mostly dominated by the male artists who looked at women as muses, we all know about it, and muses or objects, mystified, marginalized. But number of women, including Frida Kahlo, they overcame this kind of subject-object split by doing their portraits and the self-portraits. And those self-portraits questioned about the identity. They were not painted for male gaze or anything. So, and also they were reflective of their unidealized sexuality and sexuality and reality. So these were the paintings after which I did not paint for almost 12 years. Can we have next one? Yeah, so these are some works called How Perfect Perfection Can Be. And these are broadly inspired by the architectural perfection I normally get very inspired by, or a kind of visual pleasure that they give me for its scale and functionality and the perfection. And but the simultaneously the question one has is that what does one do when one also knows about, or one is also conscious about the kind of, you know, a city like New York, mega cities like New York producing more the heat trapping gases more than the whole of Central America or Mexico put together, you know, and then also it increases the climate change, and also it gives way to more and more environmental destruction. And these works are also dealing with how do we deal with the contradictory times that we are living in, about our desires, about our aspirations and concerns, whether there's going to be any turning point. So these works are taken from of the now if you look at the paintings, they are the works are superimposed by the climate change charts. So they are energy charts are cut off of PVC and transferred onto PVC. So, and also another thing which intrigues me is the characteristic of the diagrams, which include reductive, making the form almost very, very abstract. And if you don't read about, if you don't know how to read these charts, you never come to know how serious the situation is. But as an artist, I find it very interesting to use these. So this is the kind of contradictory, you know, paradoxical way that we make art. Can I have the second one? Okay, so these maps that I'm going to show here, two maps, these maps are the maps of coal mining sites in Raigarh. You know, the places that which I have visited, because I've been working there with the communities who have been protesting against coal mining there, because as they want to continue farming, and they are in favor of renewable energies like solar energy plants. So this is also the work of, this is also one of the site. And then the point I'm making here is, can we go back? The point one is making here is that to have that perfection that I was talking about, the architectural perfection that I said, that which gives a kind of kick to me. Now, without having this kind of coal mining, or you know, or without you know, having energy to be used for that kind of architectural buildings, you know, so what one is saying is that to get that, to get something which is very pleasing, one destroys the planet, you know, at the cost of, you know, which we can't even talk about, unless we change our ways of producing electricity through other means. Next, please. This is a work, Links Destroyed and Rediscovered, which I conceived and did after the Babri Masjid demolition and the communal riots we had in Bombay in 1992-93. So this work, the time that we had this and what happened in Bombay raised some very specific questions about the need to rethink about, or the need to recognize the cultural difference in Bombay city, you know, which is known for its cosmopolitan culture. Because one could see, and it was quite visible, how people from one particular community were being targeted and driven away from the city, which was their city for many, many years. And which also created a kind of psychological and physical divide. So this work was one of my first mutually consented collaborative work. And while working on this, I was also exposed to different levels of relationships in interactive and collaborative aspect of art making mode. And this was in collaboration with two filmmakers and a classical, Hindustani classical singer. Next, please. The between this work is called Between Memory and History. Between Memory and History is an interactive work. It is about reviewing and questioning whether one questioning the possibilities and problematics of artistic representation of events like Holocaust and all, and also how to deal with in distinction between the representation and reality, which I sensed while I was, you know, talking to people or interviewing people from different cities, different times, you know, who had gone through either the trauma of partition or communal violence or, you know, the riots. So I felt that while talking to them, I felt there is, despite that there is, you know, somewhat fading, you know, you know, that I felt that there was a dwindling but tenacious presence of the past.
Hello, Navjot ji, can you hear me?
individual emotions and quality. It also helped me to, can you hear me?
Hello?
Yes?
Yeah, we had lost your voice. And Navjotji, before we go on to the next slide, which is Lacuna, I would like to stop share and reshare again because I made a mistake while sharing. Otherwise, the sound won't come back. So just let me know when you want me to go on to the next one. Hello? Hello? Did we lose Navjotji?
No, she's there on the screen.
Okay. Yeah. Can you hear me, Navjotji?
Yes, I can hear you.
Yeah, yeah. Could you say a little more about memory and history? Because there was some network issues, I think. And so we could not hear what you were telling about the Holocaust and the participatory nature of the work.
Okay. So anyway, let me tell you, this is an interactive work, reviewing and questioning the possibilities and problematics of artistic representation of any particular event like Holocaust or communal riot or, you know, some such events. And and also dealing with the distinction between the representation and the reality. And which I sensed while I was sort of talking to people from different generations, you know, who had gone through the trauma of partition or communal riots in Delhi or in Bombay or in other parts of the country. And I felt that there is a dwindling but tenacious presence past, you know, in they also came across number of research again.
Shall I go for? Yeah, better. I think the network, there's some network issue. Voice keeps coming and going. So now it's back. Shall I move forward? Yeah, shall I move forward?
Okay. So that also helped me to understand how to conduct research, what position can an artist take, and no, this slide is after this. So maybe we should go back to the previous one. Can we go back to the previous one? Hello?
Yeah. You mean Lacuna or you mean between?
Yes. Yeah, because I've not yet finished it. So the paper ribbons that you see, which are tied on to the structure, iron structure, which is like fencing, contain a text on it, and this text can be just one word, it can be one line, it can be a paragraph, or it can be a superimposed text. You know, basically, if I open the ribbon and the word is trace, you know, what does trace mean to me in India? Or what does it mean to somebody, let's say, in some other country or in some? I think the viewer will respond to the word or the sentence or the story which is told on it, you know, according to their own experiences. And the work also consists of two videos and an audio work. Now we can have next one. Next one. Yes. So Lacuna in testimony, this work would not have been possible if I hadn't gone to Ahmedabad and without being with the people, you know, in the transit camps. you know, who had gone through that entire trauma of the conspired violence in Gujarat. And it was only by being with them and by interacting, being and looking in, I felt that those moments, you know, to have a dialogue was possible. But while listening to them, you know, when they over period, I had to go again and sat with them. It was more like a kind of building up a relationship with them over period. So when I went again and when actually they agreed to, you know, that they allowed me to take a tape recorder, not even a camera or anything, just a tape recorder. When I started recording them, I felt that by listening to their testimonies, I recognized that it was not possible to, it was a question for myself, you know, that whether I could, you know, really understand, even when I was trying to understand, you know, very deeply what they were saying, because I felt that there was a kind of opacity and the testimony contained lacuna. So in that situation, what I could see was threshold of indistinction, you know, between inside and outside, something which was visible and something which was not visible. So that indistinction between inside and outside was where I saw the connection. Next, please.
Shall I play the video?
Okay. Channel video, and extremely difficult for me to use, you know, or incorporate those testimonies because I didn't want to make them audible for, you know, anyone and everyone, and I felt only those who were interested should hear on the headphone. So instead, the voice I used, which
Hello.
Navjoti, yes.
Are you there? Yeah.
Can you hear me? Yes.
Yes.
So, this is a work called the title 11 years, 12 years after Lacuna and Testimony. And it was done in a particular context for a particular exhibition I was invited by, which was titled Forms of Activism. Organized by Sehmat and curated by Vivant Sundaram, in which artists were invited to make work selecting any of the topics they had. So they had Kashmir, they had conflict zones, or Mother India topic, or they had to. I chose to work on Gujarat because I wanted to revisit, because even after Latina, I had followed up what was happening there. And so I thought that this, through the conversation with the activist and with a survivor and a predator, actually, but the predator didn't turn up, and the artist, we could revisit, you know, all those years which had passed by. So this is a kind of conversation between an activist, Tisna Setalwat, who has been working in Gujarat for last 80 years, and a survivor, Rupa Modi, who, despite losing her only son in 2002, has been deeply engaged with organizational work. And her idea is that to bring people, you know, so as an organized group, they feel that they get a strength to combat, you know, I mean, they managed to combat after the after effects of the you know, conspired kind of violence in Gujarat, and they are able to deal with the present crisis, which are ongoing things. And this was also very interesting for me, because in 2014, this work was made in 2014, and that was the time when the CM of Gujarat was contesting for the, you know, prime ministership. And in 2013, Modi had been just brought just before the riots. So it was, and then also we were looking at that, how Gujarat in 2003 set itself apart and created a kind of, you know, from where evolved a kind of politics, and how the level of impunity has come to, you know, be in our political system, and which has impacted all forms of life. And if we look at from 2014, or even from 2003 to 2020, we can see how, you know, when I say that it has impacted all forms of life, including, you know, imposition of, or imposing of, right-wing mindset on the people. Next, please.
अगर हम 10-15 साल को भी लेते हैं, या उसके पहले से भी अगर गुजरात में देखें, तो मुझे ऐसा लगता है, it has set itself apart, और it has sort of set into motion a whole new kind of politics. एक नए तरह का राजनीति वहाँ से निकल के आ रही है. तो मैं सोच रही थी कि अगर हम उसके ऊपर ये आपस में कॉन्वर्सेशन के थ्रू एक के बाद एक पॉइंट्स, जो मेरे, मैं जैसा समझती हूँ, या जो आप समझते हैं, या तीस्ता समझती हैं, तो उसको अगर हम अपनी चर्चा में ला सकें.
जहाँ तक कौमी हिंसा की बात है, हमने देखा कि हमारे देश में 1980s 86 के बाद उनका कौमी हिंसा का पूरा रूप बदल गया. मतलब एक तरफ पहले हम उसको दंगा, जैसे आपने रायट्स कहा, दंगा कह सकते थे, मगर वो जो रूप बदला है कि मतलब कहीं ना कहीं प्रशासन और पुलिस और अल्पसंख्यकों के खिलाफ, मतलब एक ऐसा नहीं कि दो झुंड आपस में लड़ रहे हैं, या दो नेबरहुड्स, दो मोहल्ले, अलग अलग लोग आके, मतलब गुस्से में आके उन्होंने पथराव किया, अदला बदला की, मतलब राजनीति खेली, मगर कहीं ना कहीं साजिश के साथ एक सोच के ज़रिए प्रशासन पुलिस भी एक तरफेपन से एक माइनॉरिटी के खिलाफ काम कर रही है. हमने पूरे 80s में देखा, मेरठ, हाशिमपुरा में, उसके बाद भागलपुर में, उसके पहले सबसे पहला तो नैली में था, आसाम में 1983 में, और सिखों, हमारे सिख भाई बहनों के साथ जो 84 में हुआ, वो भी एक तरह का, तो वो तो मतलब 84 का मामला और गुजरात 2000 का मामला हम वैसे दंगा तो कह ही नहीं सकते, एक तरह का जनसंहार ही था. क्योंकि इसको हम जेनोसाइडल कार्नेज इसलिए हम इस्तेमाल करते हैं वो शब्द, क्योंकि एक पूरे अस्तित्वपन, एक पूरे धार्मिक आइडेंटिटी को कुचलने की कोशिश, और उसमें अलग अलग तरह के हिंसा का वापर का इस्तेमाल, और पूरी तरह प्रशासन और सरकार के यंत्रणा का इस्तेमाल, और ये बिना तैयारी का नहीं हो सकता. ये रातों रात 27 फरवरी में गोधरा में बहुत बड़ा ट्रेजिडी हुआ, किसी को उसका सुख नहीं था। गुलबर्ग में जो मतलब 59 लोग का कत्लेआम हुआ है एहसान जाफरी के साथ, कितने लोग इनके सोसाइटी में मारे गए नरोड़ा पाटन, किसी को गोधरा के मतलब कोई या मुसलमान हो या हिंदू किसी को सुख नहीं था जब वो ट्रेन जली गई मतलब S6 का कोच पे। मगर जिस तरह वो घटना को पेश की गई, जिस तरह प्रशासन ने कदम नहीं उठाए, इसकी वजह से गुजरात के मतलब कम से कम 14 जिले में इस तरह की हिंसा भड़की कि वो बिना पूरे साजिश और प्लानिंग के साथ नहीं हो सकती।
हेलो नवजोत जी, आर यू देयर?
यस यस। सो दिस इज द वर्क कॉल्ड वाटर वीविंग, विच इज बेस्ड ऑन द मिथ ऑफ ओरिजिन ऑफ वीविंग एज नरेटेड बाय सुखमन, अ वीवर फ्रॉम नगरनार। एंड नगरनार इज अ विलेज वेयर they had already gone through the whole procedure of very painful procedure of land acquisition for a steel plant, but central government's recent, development strategy to privatize it has further sensitized this already sensitive area. So I haven't gone after that, but things I've heard that my colleagues tell me from Bastar, things are not very good. So after that, I made another work called Tana, which I'm not able to show, which I was showing in the context of my works, how perfect perfection can be. Next, please. Hello, Navjot ji, can you hear me? Yes. You know, this whole profession of weaving is almost finished there.
Going on to water. Shall I run this while you speak?
Okay, all right. So you see this project, isn't it, Shmita? Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you. It's just about to end. Yeah. Hello? Yeah, Navjot.
Hello. Yeah. So this
yeah.
So the video that we saw, water, it evolved from our research that we carried on during our projects that we were working on. You know, the projects Nalpar, along with the communities, and I was working with four Adivasi artists, and we were trying to look at many aspects of water situation. And our work is in relation to how water is seen in relation to development and the privatization of natural resources and riparian rights. You know, because this particular place, the film begins with, is of Chitrakoot Falls, and it's very close to Indravati River. And this is the most fertile land which Tata Motors was trying to acquire from 10 villages. But fortunately, the 10 villages, they kept resisting, and they have succeeded in saving their land. So the work that you have on screen now is Touch. And this work is about desire and the need and significance of touch as a communication through body, and which I did after the loss of my partner. And the work is based on my experiences of being with Altaf. And so the whole process of making this work was quite transmuting, and I would say quite healing in a way. And so since the work is made on the experiences of being with Altaf, it was like transcending into recollection, you know, as though into a mind. It's like a recalling from memory. And so the
hello.
Yeah. I can hear that you see of many films about happy. So the idea was to metaphorically express this, and then the. You know, I had also
Hello, have we lost Navjotji? Devayan?
Yes, ma'am.
Is Navjotji offline?
No, she's still here.
She's here. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Hello.
Yes.
Yeah.
Hello.
Yeah.
Can you? Am I connected?
Yeah. Please go ahead.
Okay. So the last part was that, you know, the invited actors and actors and non-actors entered the work and became extension of my visualization of touch, but they also added in the, so it was quite an experimental way of making the work. And so that's why the narrative here is not linear. And now we have on the screen Touch 4. Touch 4 is in a way extension of Touch 1, 1, 2, 3. Remembering Altaf. And this work evolved from my conversation with a sex worker who actually had come to participate in Touch 123 with another friend of mine. But somehow she wasn't very sure how to participate in it. So, but she was open to communication and also sharing her experience of being in this profession and how she feels that this profession is not acceptable to the, you know, the social world that we live in. So that actually moved me, and I thought of doing a second part of Touch, and it's called Touch 4. And after that, after a considerable, research in Bombay City, I came across a play which was put up by the sex workers themselves, and they were enacting they were actually acting in the play. They had directed with the help of a professional theater director from Marathi theater. And so after meeting them, they called me to Sangli. They were all from Sangli and they belonged to an organization called Sangram. So they were sex workers and activists simultaneously. So when I went to Sangli, I had to make many visits because it was quite, the whole process was quite complex. It was not, like here I would like to say that, you know, it's when we say we work with the communities, it's not, or we work with people, it's not so easy because our subjectivities actually don't dissolve, into contact, you know, so suddenly or automatically. So have concentrated on that representation, but they didn't like the idea of actors being involved. They said they actors act because they are paid, but this is our life and we like. So my advice was actually discuss collectively with them in Sangli on many of my visits, and they were also very strict about looking at the
Joji, the network at your end is keeps going off, so I'll play the video for the time being.
Till they finalize it. Sometimes, you know, that's how this work was made, and then they were invited for the opening, and they were where they could directly, or people who had questions with me that how, while working, what happened, you know, how could you work with them? So they were there to talk to people directly about their experience of working with an artist and about their own experiences that people wanted to know of being in that profession.
Shall I play the video?
Yes, next please.
अभी आप पढ़ी लिखी हो, आपको मैं बोलूंगी आप जाओ खेत में काम करो, आपको हो सकेगा
नहीं।
फिर ऐसा ही हमारा भी जिंदगी, यही हम दुनिया को सब समाज को दुनिया को समझाने का प्रयत्न करते हैं। नहीं कैसा है मन में जो समाज वाले हैं कि नहीं, एक ऐसा समझते हैं हम भी एक समाज के घटक ही है, उनके दिमाग में क्या है, धंधा करने वाली औरत एक अलग ही प्राणी है ऐसा समझते हैं हम औरत है, पहले औरत है ये देखो आप कोई भी रहने दो, पहला शादीशुदा रहने दो या धंधा करने वाले रहने दो या नौकरी करने वाले रहने दो, औरत है ना, बाद में वो नौकरी करने वाली है, बाद में वो धंधा करने वाली है, बाद में वो शादीशुदा है, पहले ऐसा सब ये जो है कि ना समाज के दिमाग में ये सब हटाने के लिए हम लोग का भी जो नाटक है ना वो समाज के सामने रख रहे हैं। तो कोई भी कायदा कानून ऊपर के लेवल से बनाते हैं और बोलते हैं कि इनके लिए बना है, उससे पहले से ज्यादा हम पे अन्य अत्याचारी होता है। तो ये वो लोग सोचते नहीं है कि हम लोग इनके लिए कायदा कानून बना रहे हैं, हमारे लिए बना रहे हैं ना, हमारे भी आप कुछ तो समझ लो उसमें कि किस तरह से कायदा कानून बनाने से हमको मदद होएगा, उल्टा वो हम पे अत्याचार होने जैसा ही बनाते हैं। तो अभी जो ट्रैफिकिंग और सेक्स वर्क जो एकत्रीकरण किए हैं उन लोगों ने, ट्रैफिकिंग ये अलग ही है और सेक्स वर्क ही अलग ही है। सेक्स वर्क अपने आप मुझे सब लोग और हम भी ये मानते हैं कि जिसको करने के लिए उसको बहुत कुछ करना है। अच्छा, तो ये थोड़ा अलग अलग विषय है, ये आप एकत्रित करके जो हमारा आवाज़ है, हम हमारे अधिकार के लिए जो लड़ रहे हैं उसको आप दबाने का कोशिश कर रहे हो सरकार। तो ट्रैफिकिंग सिर्फ धंधे में होते हैं ऐसा नहीं, जो फैक्ट्री होते हैं उसमें भी कहीं लड़के लोग को बच्चों लोग को ला के लगाते हैं, अलग अलग कारण से है। तो आप धंधे से ही क्यों जुड़ रहे हो, सिर्फ धंधे में होता है ऐसा नहीं है, कितने कारण है, तो वो अलग विषय है, उसको अलग करो। जो भी धंधे में आए और वो सब ट्रैफिकिंग हो के आए, मतलब उनको सबको जबरदस्ती लाए, जो जबरदस्ती जिसको लाए उसके बारे में आप सोचो, और ये एकत्रीकरण करो मत आप, क्योंकि ट्रैफिकिंग सिर्फ धंधे में होता है ऐसा नहीं, हर जगह में होता है, हर कारण से होता है।
Navjot ji?
Yes.
Yeah. Soul, breath and wind.
Soul, breath, wind is a work which has evolved from my interaction, from my research with the communities engaged with coal mining, who are protesting against the powerful forces committing crime by increasing the vulnerability to the ecosystem, you know, in their area. And the land for Adivasi, if you see, is everything of theirs is based on, you know, land, and land for them is life and livelihood. And they feel that if you know, there is a saying there that if soil is destroyed, the soul is killed. So even though the mining is considered, you know, vital for the, you know, development of the country, despite its reckless you know, impact or the, you know, furious energy that it moves with in other you know, direction, in opposite direction, creating a lot of violence. And strangely, that violence is not even seen as violence, you know, because it is supposed to be for the well-being of the society. So the question which constantly emerges from this, you know, discussion with them is that if this is development for the well-being of the society, for everyone on the planet, how is that that everyone here living on the planet, whether human or non-human or insects, or, are facing the high consequences, risks and environmental threats, and which actually, I like the term very much, which Beck and Giddens, a social scientist, call manufactured risks. So we are manufacturing risks. So if you see on this, in this video, on right hand side, since we are, I don't know whether we are seeing the video, on right hand side is when people are speaking, in the, and on the left hand side is what is going on in my mind while listening to them. This I call slow violence. If you see the way this, you know, pollution is increasing.
हेलो नवजोत जी.
यस यस आई कैन सी एंड आई कैन हियर यू. सो यू कैन सी दैट दीज आर you know, like fossils of insects, and it is actually an extension of soil breath wind, because while being in that area and by being on the sites which are huge, massive, human is like an ant, and every little living being, and as we know that insects also contribute to the ecosystem, and they indicate, you know, this whole philosophy of patterns which connect, and which Gregory Bateson, you know, he calls it patterns which connect, but it means, it indicates interconnectedness and interdependence. I think that's what we have forgotten, that you know, the everything is interdependent, and you cannot isolate things, and you know, just, you know, very callously or insensitively, you know, just sort of just, you know, erase them from the existence. And then this is also it's a little fun work. I did a kaleidoscope using my footage of the insects that I kept you know, recording while being in those areas, and by being with people, sometimes, you know, the certain areas which are not affected are so beautiful. You know, when you say, you know, heaven is beautiful, if you are in one of those areas, it's so beautiful, and then you should see the kind of insects, the kind of maybe we need to, you know, remind ourselves all the time by turning, you know, like in kaleidoscope, it becomes a pattern. So this is also called patterns which connect, you know, because I really have understood the philosophy of nature, and which actually the emphasis is on, you know, nature also functions in a way that where everything is interdependent on everything. So in with that in mind, I did this work also. Both are called patterns which connect, the fossils which are sculptures, and this is a video. And it was projected on the roof of on the dome in NGMA Bombay. This, yes, next please.
Yeah, Mary wants to read a book.
Yes, Mary wants to read a book. Mary wants to borrow a book. Mary wants to buy a book, and Mary wants to own a book. Is a title, which actually this is my original title, but in Kochi Biennale we used only Mary wants to read a book, is actually derived from an indigenous saying when they say that we don't own land, we borrow from our children. The concept is that when we borrow something, we have to be careful and we have to return it. The moment we own something and we think we have the power, we start, and we can also, human mind can also be creative, and human mind can be also very destructive, so they can abuse it. So keeping that in mind, and also keeping in mind, you see, this work was done specifically for Kochi Biennale, and everything was done in Kochi itself. And I see it from the perspective of ecology, because I was looking at Kochi as one of the cities situated on the sea, and all the cities situated on the sea are vulnerable to climate change and you know, increase of global warming. And but looking at the state, they have very rich biodiversity, plus they have 100% literacy, and they've had a library culture. So my work in a way is a tribute to both literacy movement and the library culture. So the, if we can go to the first slide, please. the it's not a representation of the real library as such. So yes. So, and the other one, please, the colored one. So and the structure and the books, the one yes, you know, books that you see here, the jackets of the books are designed based on study charts 2000 years of continental climate change, and the bars, you know, the colors of the bars denote the warming and the cooling in those years, and then the paper used for can we see one detail of this, the paper, okay, maybe this is the detail, the paper used for the collage, you know, for the entire structure, and the books are made of all recycled material, recycled newspapers from Kerala and from Bombay. And you know, environmental periodicals that I collected over periods during my research. And every book has one page designed by the artist. And the books could be taken away by the viewers in the last 2 weeks of Kochi Biennale. Next, please.
Yeah, can you see this? Empty containers. Hello?
Yes, empty containers. Now, empty containers was, hello, can you hear me?
Yeah, yes.
So, empty containers was a part of a project called Yamuna LB Contemporary Flows, Fluid Times. And I was one of the artists who was invited to Hamburg to see the possibility if I could develop a work around Elbe River, because rest of the artists were working on Yamuna River in in Delhi. So some of us were invited there, and I got interested in understanding the difference between dredging for natural purposes and dredging for the trade links, to sustain the trade links. And in the process, I learned that how this riverbed was deepened 7 times since 1850. And they were thinking of deepening it by 1 more meter because they wanted the bigger ships to arrive and leave even during low tide. So, and actually when I came to know that the original depth of the river was only 4 meters, and now at that time when they were thinking of deepening, it was already 15.5. So they were going to deepen it for, by another meter or so. So anyway, by all these were details and data and all that, but what also intrigued me, the presence of containers everywhere in the city that I went to, whether I was driving, whether I was walking, there were containers everywhere. So I looked at containers as that the words containers and river both have metaphorical connotation, you know, to and metaphors actually allow us to experience, allow us to understand, you know, the one domain of experiences, you know, in terms of the other. So I looked at when you see these books, there are 4,000 books. I made them in the form of a container. And then it occurred to me that I could make this interactive project, and I called it Empty Containers, in the form of books, and which is actually an idea used in place of another, as both are containers, you know, and of materials, knowledge, and connection and interconnection. I love using this word interconnection. And then this book also, each book has just one phrase which is taken, derived from all kinds of German, Indian, from the world, or indigenous, you know, sayings or phrases. And since it was LB, Yamuna, two rivers that we were looking at, it occurred to me that, you know, in India, we believe that a dip in Yamuna frees us from the fear of death. whereas my I subverted it by saying, because the looking at the condition of Yamuna or the pollution in it, which is 3,000 more, that time it was 3,000 times more than it should have been. I mean, the natural Yamuna should be. So water of Yamuna should be. So my phrase was, a dip in Yamuna fills me with the fear of death. So like this, they were made, each one had, you know, in English and in German. So this was also a collaborative project, and done with the two German collaborators and one in. You see, can we go to the very first one, please? Ushmita, can you hear me?
Yeah, I've gone to the first slide.
Yeah, so the very first, so this was then installed on the industrial cart. And this was the ship on the left-hand side. When you see, there is a ship here. And in that ship, the entire exhibition happened. And this is Yamuna, this is the river. So can we move to next, please?
Sure. Body City Flows image.
Yes, this work is, this is a work called Body City Flows. This I have done while I researched on four river basins in Bombay City. But the state of all the rivers have been reduced to nalas, you know, and because of the, you know, abuse to the natural assets, etc. So I then tried to, I was looking at it, and then I was also looking at a number of other things along with this research, and I understood that how, you know, the water flows, you know, because I also got into the philosophy of construction also, but anyway, we don't have the slide of that. So, and this is a tap, you know, and then one more is of hand pump. So if we have used, you know, these designs, which come from their sensibilities and they're relative to their cultural experiences, the community's cultural experiences. And so these designs were also, you know, finalized by the people, and they are built by the artists. So when someone asked us, why don't you build these? So they said, we are peasants and these people are artists, but we are there to help them and to look after them. After all, these are built with the people, for the people, and they are not, they have not ended up as products. They cannot be transported. They cannot be sold, or they cannot be. So this whole point of, you know, authorship here is, you know, also we had to sort of, you know, discuss. Then it comes to, you know, what happens to the documentation of. Now for documentation, each one of us are free to use it the way we want, because number of villages take photographs in front of these, because for them these become little monuments and all. So, but as long as it doesn't become a product, it doesn't get sold, or if for some reason, if it is collected by any collector, the money which we get from it, that we have decided, it will go back to a project like this through the organization.
This is still from the play Lal Pen.
Yes. So then the like I told you that the center Dia that we have built there in Bastar. Now you have, so the Diya was built because we were already working from another center built by another very, very well-known, internationally known Adivasi artist, Jaydev. But after a while, when we intervened in public spaces, if I intervened in a public spaces, my colleagues also intervened in public spaces in their own area, because the tradition of making art is very different there. So they felt that Shilpi Gram, which is a center run by Jaydev Bagil, now Jaydev Bagil is no more, they felt that our work did not fit in their idea of traditional art, and they asked us to leave. So that is how we conceived and built Dia. And So Diya is also a center, a place, a cultural space where we, you know, feel that where we are able to, you know, allow critical, you know, views, and also to be able to apply critical thinking. And that happens during our seminars and which we call Sambad. So this is for which we also invite theater people, not only from Bastar, but from Orissa and from the border of Chhattisgarh or from anywhere actually. So there are also PhD students here, art students and artists and a lot of local writers and artists from, you know, who are working in the style of Adivasi art, you know, forms. So this is an image of our one of the seminars, which we call Value of Nature. Value nature or off in bracket. So this is the last slide I'm showing. And when I say that at this stage of my life, I want to create those spaces. So this is one of the space we have collaboratively, you know, created with the, you know, between, that is my four Adivasi colleagues and with the community people. By after working on Nalpar project and Pillaguri, a relationship with the villagers and the neighboring communities had also become little more where they accepted us, where they invited us to their homes and for weddings and all that. You know, not as somebody who had come from outside from the city, but also as they said, now you are from our own area. So those are the moments actually also become for us very important, where we can watch them, you know, from very close proximity. They can watch us from very close proximity. And the one more point I want to make here is that, you know, that what happens is what we are seeing here is an now outcome of the project, which is a complete project. But what happened with practices like this is also that which people miss out is the whole process. What happens is even during the process, the number of people who are working, you know, there you have to see what kind of agency people have, what kind of freedom do they have, what kind of rules they have made for themselves, where is the absence, where they are imposing. So the in between, so what I feel the people miss out on, looking at people from close proximity, because this practice is very different from studio-based practice where you make something and something reaches somewhere, you know. Okay. So this is not like that. So sometimes, but at the same time, I also feel that even when they are looking at a work like this, they also need to pay attention to what must have happened during the process. And so who tells you about that? Who comes to see that? But some of the people have visited us while we have been working there. And so the conversation or our discussion with those people who have visited or those who have seen us working together have been a little different.
Right. Well, thank you for such an enlightening presentation. And I think all of us have got a very clear idea of the kind of practices that you have been involved in and the various kind of resources that you have looked at, whether it be violence, whether it be, you know, indigenous communities or sex workers. So coming from the last few slides where you're also talking about your engagement with indigenous community in Chhattisgarh or Bastar. So my question kind of arises from a place of ethics and engagement from this ethical perspective. So how important in this kind of a practice is sustained involvement in collaborative practices, especially keeping in mind that at many times communities simply end up becoming the resource for the artist.
Yes. So You know, for here, when you first of all, there's a question of intervention for me because I have intervened there. Then the second the Adivasi are in relationship with the community. So there are, you know, it's not just one thing, it's step by step, you know. So I think that for us, for me, first of all, I had to really learn, I had to learn to develop a vision free of, you know, preconditioning. I also went with my own, you know, baggage, you know, I had a kind of art training and I was thinking in a particular way. I had read a lot. That's different. But when you are in that space, you know, my friend Jaydev Baghel, who I was friendly for almost 30 years when I went there, but the moment I went there, my equation with him changed because I was in his place. So many times we would have conflict, we would argue about why we are different. So one thing is that it's very important that is such a
hello
is demands recognition of Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
So what I was saying that you know the self reflection is very important to begin with,
and also
and which you have to actually constantly. And now I'm working not only in Southern Bastar, but I'm also working in Northern Central part of you know Chhattisgarh, you know, in Raigarh area where you know people are protesting against coal mining because they are in favor of solar energy because they want to continue farming, and it's possible even if we stop now. Mm-hmm. And so I am, you know, sort of I go there sometimes when they have their protests and all that, or sometimes I just go there. And sometimes I feel when I'm looking in, you know, and that
really sad. The network at her end today is now, Joji, can you hear me? You are on mute.
Actually, you know, not here.
Yeah, actually, I think, unfortunately, I think the network at your end has, you know, played truant today.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah, I can. So, so another question that I had in mind was that many of your works, you know, such as Links Destroyed and Rediscovered or Between Memory and History, look into this artistic representation of certain traumatic events, such as fundamentalism and its fallouts or Holocaust, via an engagement with individual and collective memory. So how do you navigate multiple versions of past events while also addressing, you know, this current authoritarian tendency of historical revisionism?
You know, I'm very much interested in the context, you know, in the context that one is working in. But simultaneously,
Richa, can you hear me?
Interested in a historical perspective.
And also, can you hear me now?
Yeah, I mean, we lost you completely in this answer. Could you repeat again?
It's going. So I said that for me, understanding the context is as important as looking at things historically.
Right.
Could you hear me?
Yeah, this part I did.
And it's something like, you know, I recently read, looking at things from far away and looking at things from close up and looking at things from everywhere in between. So, you know, it's like looking at things from the distance, you know, like when you are doing a research, sometimes you're distant from the event which has already happened, you know. Mm-hmm. So, and then something which has just happened, you know. Now, for example, what do I do with, how do I position myself? Like I said in the introduction, you know, which I read out, that how do I position myself during such, people. So many a time you position yourself as a witness from distinct levels. Projects are very lengthy, you know. It takes me very long, you know, to come to, you know, they materialize in long time.
Right. So I'll ask up a couple of questions from our attendees, and unfortunately, we would have to end within the next 5 minutes. An anonymous attendee asks, first he or she thanks you for your talk. They say deeply evocative installations and use of multiple sensory registers. I'm stuck by your equation of visual erasure and silence. I wanted to ask what water means to you. That's what they're asking.
Water.
Yeah.
What water means to me.
Yeah.
Water to me is, it depends which water it is, you know. I mean, if you really see the way I sort of, you know, looked at Arabian Sea when I did lacuna in testimony, I was looking at water at that time as a source of transportation, you know. So the water can also be seen. But then, it depends how you are looking at water. You know, you can look at water, which is a source for life. It's called a life. I mean, it's a source of life, you know, that without water
you
cannot
survive. And you also compared it to the circulatory system in your work.
Yes. Yes. Yeah, flow of the river. Flow. You know, and I always have this, I sort of coined this, you know, what is supposed to, looking at the state of our creeks in Bombay where all these four rivers go and meet. If you see, whatever is supposed to flow doesn't flow because it is so polluted, you know. So, and that's why this whole concept of constructal philosophy I have liked very much, and they talk about what flow means, you know. So I'm interested in that concept of flow.
Yeah, I remember, I think I had noted down that, you even refer to this Marxist idea of the nothing is static and that everything, life is a flow and all flow systems are life systems. I think that is something that you have talked about before.
I've talked it in the context of one work I did called Mithi River. You see, Mithi. Yeah. So in that I talk about that.
So one of our audience from Facebook, Arpita Akhanda, she asks, can you share how each community project that you have done has changed or evolved you?
It definitely has broadened my understanding, you know. The world. You see, when people say that non-literate cultures are not educated, but I personally feel that even the cultures which have not
gone through the kind of education model that we have, we are familiar with, but their experiences, lived experiences, and their understanding of whether it's nature or whether it is life or whether it's forest, so it is based on their experiences, which I call practices. Myself have actually theory or philosophy of life, and at another level you experience how people understand that. Now, for example, I'll give you the maybe this can be the last example, that this whole concept of deep ecology, which is a very new thing in the Western world, and they talk about it and all that, but deep ecology actually is so much part of Adivasi consciousness. Now, for example, deep ecology means that human is not separated from non-human, So the patterns which connect, which Gregory Bateson, that his whole philosophy that, when you experience and when people are practicing that, they're not speaking about it. They're not screaming, shouting and telling us that this is philosophy, this is theory and this is that. But, it's very interesting for me to experience it. Then it's very interesting for me to read it. So when I read, sometimes I find it easier to understand, this means this and this. And strangely, then when you, if you have by chance met someone of the younger, philosopher or something, and you start talking with them, they would say exactly, so that also confirms, or consolidates my own way of looking at things, that, you experience something, you read something. So there is, so same with the communities, you work with different people, so you have access to different knowledge systems.
Right. So Navjotji, we'll come to a conclusion with one last question. Would you have any advice for the, for younger artists who want to start projects, doing this kind of work with arts, activism, youths and community? So what would your advice to them be?
Very difficult to give advice because I don't want to sound like a teacher, but I would say that one needs to sensitize oneself. Like I talked about the critical reflection, Somebody asked me a question, helps one to work towards,
It's so unfortunate today, Richa.
Yes, but we still could take out whatever best we could. Yeah. We have to have this live sometime.
I'm sorry, Navjotji, we kind of completely lost that answer. Would you like to revisit it once more before we end?
You want me to answer that question again?
Yeah, yes. The network just completely went away at that point.
So you can hear me now?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
So like I said, that I wouldn't like to sound like a teacher. I'm not one and I don't like doing that. But I, according to my own experience, I would say that one needs to sensitize oneself, And what is sensitizing? And sensitizing is that, also it's like critical reflection. And critical reflection also helps you to work towards developing a vision, And that vision which is free of... The assumption, we have, because you have grown up in a particular place. So, but when you are interested in doing anything, you have to understand, you have to sensitize yourself, because things may not be according to what we have experienced, Right. So, that's the only thing I can share with.
Thank you so much. I think, there's a lot of food for thought today for our viewers. And I take back with me, we've had several chats, and I've been, before we came on to the
conversation today. I did a lot of research on your work, and I think in a way it has helped me to understand your processes much more deeply than when I was just looking at the images or reading about it. But this conversation, this understanding from your perspective has really deepened that empathy with almost some of the projects that you've done. Richa, would you like to say something?
No, I really would love to have the session live sometime, because there are so many questions. And I think, the minute you kind of see each image and then hear you talk about it, and then I think when you're at this next one, a whole lot of, it's like a plethora of questions which come up, which need a lot of in-depth discussion and understanding. So I'm very excited about what we take back today and all the food for thought. So definitely, thank you so much.
Thank you so much. And I would like to
thank you very much.
Thank you. And I would like to remind our viewers that we tomorrow, 4 o'clock onwards, we have a conversation with Ranbir Kalika ji. So please do join in. And thank you so much, Nazrul ji. It's a pleasure hearing from you.
Thank you for having me. Thank you very much.
Our honor and our pleasure.
Thank you. Thank you, Richa.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye.